So the we're going to load the detector test template that contains the setup for the Pico640 Gen2. The full part number is Pico640-046. But before we do anything, we're going to go up to disconnect, run the disconnect test plan, and make sure that all the clocks and biases are off. Save to disconnect. And we know this has happened because the LEDs on the front of the board are off. Now, there is one LED on the rear of the board that remains on, but this only indicates that the USB cable is connected. So it's fine if that's on as long as the bias LEDs are off. We disconnected, I've connected my static strap. Now I can plug in the part. This is the Pico 640 part. On the carrier board, the top row of pins is longer than the bottom row of pins, and the sockets on the main board, again, the longer one is on top. So I can line these up, gently press it into place, and then push my lens up against the board until the baffle is as close as it will get. Now we're connected. Normally, the first pattern output is connected to the clock input on the AIM, and this is for detectors that do not produce their own frame start and line start. This particular detector does produce a frame start and line start, so we're going to take this cable, disconnect it from the pattern generator, and connect it to this output on the detector board. So the detector board will take a master clock input from the clock drivers and the pattern generator, generate frame start and line start, and these will then go to the AIM, and then through the AIM to the acquisition system. So I'm going to now run setup Pico 640, and first I will open PyPlot so I can see if it collects data properly. I click go. The instructions tell me to ensure that the USB port is connected and that I've moved the clock cable. I will set up my device with the correct number of outputs, the gain value, GFID and GSK. These will be from the device specific test report that you get from Ulis, and we're going to use the default clock frequency of 19.1 megahertz and the default integration time of 65.2 microseconds.
GFID as well.
Continue. Abort. Scott has just told me that this value is incorrect.
2.85.
And you change that to 2.85. Okay. Once the I2C has been programmed for these values, especially this one, which turns on the run bit for the chip, now you will see the LEDs blinking on the acquisition card. Until it programs this bit, even though the pattern generator is running, the clocks will not be flowing through the board, and so this won't go on until this step executes. Now the part is running. We have uncorrected video. I'll run this continuously. I have a lens cap on, so you don't see much, but you can see the numbers are changing, and we have a distribution and some hot pixels and some dead pixels. Let's take off the lens cap. You probably can't see this on the monitor. There is some change, and you can see the histogram moving around, but there's not much contrast. We can increase the contrast by going to the histogram, clicking and dragging our first cursor to the left edge of our data, push the tab key on the keyboard, and then grab this one and put it around here. And then on the grayscale, we scale to cursors, and now this is the best contrast we can get with a lens, but no correction. So I can see my hand, but obviously there's a lot of fixed components. Let's do a two-point calibration. So I will stop the continuous acquisition and run detector test and calibration. I'll click go. These numbers here are dummy numbers that don't affect any calculations. Here's where we want to tell the system how we want to test the part. 50 frames of data. I'm going to guess that the delta T I'm going to apply is about 5 degrees. These are my tolerances for a bad pixel. I am not going to use a programmable blackbody. I am not going to use offline data, and I'm not going to test the midpoint temperature for residual non-uniformity. If I click go, it'll instruct me to put a cold flat field against the detector. And let's take a look also here at the histogram. I'm going to acquire a data set that's 50 frames of a cold flat field. Acquired. Let's take a look at our histogram here. You can see the same distribution we saw before. And now I'm going to put a hotter flat field using the palm of my hand to cover the lens. And when I click OK and acquire a data set, take a look at the distribution on the histogram. It's going to have the same general shape. It's just going to shift to the right a little bit, and the average value will go up from 0.977 to 1.037, so about 40 millivolts of difference, but the same shape of the distribution, it just shifted to the right a little bit. I'm gonna shrink down these two windows, and we have our Excel file here with a bad column and a couple of other bad pixels. That's expected for this particular detector. I have a noise value, responsivity, and E delta T. Now I can go to non-uniformity corrected and bad pixels replaced. Run. I turn off the scaling so that it scales to the minimum and maximum values in the data set or in the frame. And now I have good fully corrected video. For some detectors where you do not get a lot of photo response from a hot flat field, it may be useful to run a simple one-point nuke, which we can use the nuke one live, which calls the DLL nuke one, and nuke one calls only a single function with a single argument, which is offsets.dta created from the detector test and calibration test plan. With nuke one, it performs a single point non-uniformity correction and no bad pixel replacement. And you can see a dark pixel there in the center of my hand and a couple of bright pixels. But most of the non-uniformity is in the offset, not in the photo response. So a one-point nuke looks pretty good. Another very useful feature of the system is the ability to display a real-time noise plot. So in order to do that, we're going to take our lens cap and put it back over the lens. Move that out of the way. Turn off the continuous acquisition, go to real-time noise, and there are two mnemonics here. One of them calls noise.ini and one calls noise and bad pixel replacement. If you have a good pixel replacement table, leave this one selected and then click go. It's going to require 50 frames of data and then plot our real-time noise. So this will update about once every second or two, and we can see an average value. I just touched something. It's going to display an average value of about 400 microvolts, which is a very good result for this microbolometer. And we can see that the grayscale plot was pretty random. There's some waviness that could be caused by our bias cables being next to some noise generating forces like the AIM. But if the bias cables are away from the power supply and other noise sources, and this detector is stable, you should see a nice Gaussian distribution and a noise number that is consistent with your predictions. If you don't have a good bad pixel map, then you can run the real-time noise plot without the bad pixel correction. If I run this one, if you have some hot pixels, you may see the histogram shifted over to the left or to the right. And again, you can fix that by placing cursors here and here, maximizing the display. When we're done with our testing, it is very important to run the disconnect test plan before detaching your connector. So make sure that the real-time imaging is turned off. Make sure that this is turned off. Then select the disconnect test plan. When we go, it says Press OK to shut down. And if we look here on the interface board, we see that this bias LED is on. And as soon as we click OK, that LED is now off. And the software tells us clocks and biases are off. The DUT is safe to connect or disconnect. I can put my static strap back on. Slide the lens and baffle back and remove my detector. Put it back in my static safe box. And we're good.